Alrighty, hello again, everyone, and welcome to the Daily Caller podcast, the Friday video edition, as you've become accustomed to. And as we do on Fridays, we suck a normal human being with something better to do out of their life and into your world and into our studio. And this week's victim is Dinesh D'Souza. His new book, Death of a Nation, Plantation Politics and the Making of the Democratic Party. It's also a major motion picture out now as well. Welcome to the show, Dinesh.
Thank you very much.
Congratulations on the book and the movie.
Thank you.
Let's talk just a little bit in general about your business model now almost. You are coupling books with documentaries. In the past, it used to be you just put out a book, you did all the research, you got all the footnotes, you've written many of those New York Times bestsellers. Now that you've coupled it with a documentary, especially with a successful Hollywood producer, the production value on your documentaries is amazing compared to most conservative documentaries. Do you find it more effective to have the two-pronged approach than just a book that sells a ton of copies?
It's the book promotes the movie promotes the book, so it's good that way. It's also good because the book is an intellectual product. If people look at the movie and they go, well, where'd you get that? I'll give you an example. We have a scene in the movie where a group of senior Nazis, the head of the Justice Department, and top Nazi officials are drafting the Nuremberg laws. And they have in their hands the Democratic Party laws of the Jim Crow South. And they look at it and they go, this is it. This is what we wanted. We want to do to the Jews what the Democrats are doing to the blacks.
So
and
the Nuremberg purity laws were essentially based on Jim Crow?
They were lifted. They were modeled on Jim Crow. Now, this is not in the history books. It's not on the History Channel. But it's irrefutable fact. It's from a transcript. There's a Yale legal scholar, James Whitman, in his book, Hitler's American Model. He lays it all out. But when people watch the movie, they're like, where are you getting that, Dinesh? And it turns out the book gives you the references, the footnotes. So they're kind of a dangerous 1-2 combination. One has the goods and the data, and the other gives you the dramatic emotional experience of being there and actually seeing what happened in the 30s, stuff that's been completely covered up.
Your movies are eminently entertaining, and just a bit about the movie making in general, because most conservative documentaries and movies with a conservative message are terrible. How did you enter into, first of all, a partnership with your producer with such a pedigree in Hollywood? And how did you avoid the trappings that most, I don't want to name any names, but everybody knows who they are, who makes these quick hit documentaries, 90 minutes, half an hour to an hour, that are just terrible? Like, how did you avoid, did you consciously avoid that, or did you just happen to find the perfect
partner? I had seen some of these documentaries, conservative documentaries, even Christian documentaries, and I was like, wow, I don't want to do that.
They just beat you over the
head
with the message.
They're trying
to forget the entertainment.
They're trying to do messaging, and they don't realize that's not what a movie is. People pay $10 to see a movie because they want to take their family, they want to have a good time. Now, if you make an entertaining movie, you can put a lot of facts into it, and people will digest them. I went to see Jerry Mollen, who's a longtime partner of Steven Spielberg. I just told him my story about America, and he goes, well, that's my story. And I go, well, what do you mean? I'm from India. He goes, no. He goes, I went out to Hollywood when I was a young man, and I drove trucks on the Universal Studios lot. And I worked my way up, so I became a producer with an Academy Award to show for it.
And he produced Schindler's List, Days of Thunder,
Jurassic Park,
a ton of movies. He hasn't worked much in Hollywood of late since he hooked up with you.
Well, he's retired, so he doesn't care. Okay. I mean, he's already got his reputation. But he helped me figure out how to make good movies.
Right.
And we shoot these movies. In fact, this movie, we have these incredible recreations of early fascism. And initially, I wanted to shoot them in Dallas. But then I realized that American actors are just too happy looking and red-cheeked to work as Nazis. And so we went to Europe. We went to Munich and Prague. We found German-speaking actors. And so the feeling of being in this movie and watching what's going on with Mussolini's fascism, with Hitler, it's mind-blowing. And it's because we take the trouble to shoot these movies like a feature film.
You have written many, many bestsellers. I have a bunch of them here. The last one, The Big Lie, caused a lot of controversy. This one is going to cause a lot of controversy because you expose, and you do so in the personages of Richard Spencer, who is the white nationalist alt-writer who the media paints as this ultra-right winger. And in The Big Lie, you address basically how the Nazis have been accused, now retroactively accused of being right-wingers. But it was the National Socialist German Workers' Party. The socialist part is pretty important because Hitler actually was an advocate of socialism. American socialists, American progressives, did admire until he was exposed, what Hitler and Mussolini were doing and trying to do from a policy perspective before they were exposed as the monsters. Talk a little bit about that morphing and that bastardization of the definition of terms by the American left and how successful it has been.
Fascism is the ideology of the centralized state. Mm-hmm. Mussolini used to say, everything in the state and nothing outside the state. The state controls the economy, it controls the banks, it controls healthcare, it runs your life. Now, that's not a right-wing ideology. Conservatives are the philosophy of individual liberty.
Right. The ultimate right-wing would be anarchy, almost, with no rules.
And in the 30s, especially in the early 30s, the progressives admired Mussolini. Some of them, like W.E.B. Du Bois, had nice things to say about Hitler. And for their part, the Nazi newspapers were wildly crazy, praising FDR. Mussolini reviews FDR's book in a magazine. He goes, hey, this guy's one of us. He's a fascist. Now, all of this has been covered up by progressive historiography subsequently. What I do in the movie that I think is crushing is I said, look, I'm even going to question the so-called Charlottesville narrative. This is the elephant.
This is where you can get into serious trouble just because that is, it's such an emotional issue. Nobody tries to talk about it logically. Nobody tries to talk about the facts. It is all bad emotion manipulation.
Now, look, it was a real tragedy.
Yeah,
someone died, you know.
They're Nazi. They're awful people. They're awful people.
Right, so that's not the issue. The issue is this. Are those awful people on the right or on the left?
Right.
Now, I found out over a year ago that Jason Kessler, the organizer of Charlottesville, had a long left-wing background. He was an Obama guy. He was an Occupy Wall Street guy. So think about it. Right away, you know something's fishy. An Obama guy becomes a white supremacist. What's going on, right? But the media, which knew about this, nevertheless did not want to look into this guy's background, even though local Charlottesville papers would point out he has an interview with, they did an interview with his girlfriend, and she goes, Jason Kessler would not date me because he considered me too conservative, you know? So this is, he was so left-wing. When I pointed this out on Twitter, Jason Kessler makes a video denouncing me, but essentially confirming that he's a leftist. So in this movie, we get the ultimate poster boy of white supremacy, Richard Spencer. And in a very revealing interview, lasts about 4 minutes in the movie, you begin to see that this guy's not only on the left, he's on the far left.
His heroes, his favorite, he doesn't like President Reagan.
No.
His favorite president, he lists Polk, and he lists Andrew Jackson, the founder of the Democratic Party. The guy who basically told the Supreme Court, get bent, I'm still going to move those Indians off their land down south. You can send your army, Supreme Court, if you have one. He was really very close to an authoritarian. And what the left does, what these Nazis do, I don't know if they're Nazis or not, I don't think they're smart enough to know, but they are authoritarians. That is not of the right.
It's not of the right.
They want the same power that progressives want. They just want to use it slightly differently, right?
Yeah, and you know, we literally in the Big Lie and in the new book, I showed that Hitler admired the Jacksonian Democrats because Hitler was sitting in Landsberg prison, and Hitler goes, I have a problem. We Germans, we can't colonize like the British and the French because they've taken India, they've taken Africa, they've taken all the real estate in the world. What do I do? And then Hitler goes, wait a minute, I have an idea. The Jacksonian Democrats in America threw the native Indians off their land, drove them further west. The ones that stayed, they killed them. The ones that were alive, they enslaved them. Hitler goes, I'll do that to the Poles and the Slavs and the Russians. And again, this is in Mein Kampf, and this is in the record. So here's Hitler actually taking a page from the Democratic Party, taking a page from the progressives with his eugenic ideas, shaping the Nuremberg laws based upon the democratic laws of the Jim Crow South. All of this, which is in the historical record, the progressives have put under the carpet, and in a very cunning move, they tried to move fascism into the right-wing column so that they could pin it on their adversaries.
How did that start, and how did it get so successful? Because they now use the term progressive. I'm a progressive. If you really look at the history of progressives, it is based on race. It is the idea that we can breed out undesirable races and stupid people and have just the ruling elite, of course, self-appointed. That is a horrible history. Nobody would say we're the new Klan. It's totally different. But essentially, progressive originally was about the same. A lot of Klansmen were progressives. They believed the power of government. How did it change?
That's the key thing, is that the left was able to distort the record. So Hitler, for example, saw himself as progressive.
Mm-hmm.
Mengele, Josef Mengele, the great,
horrible
Nazi doctor of Auschwitz, he saw himself as improving humanity. And in fact, someone once asked him, how could you do what you did? And he goes, well, listen, I didn't invent the concentration camp. It was already there. I was merely taking my opportunity, you may say, to do experiments on people there to improve humanity. So improving humanity, moving the world forward, this was the progressive drive of Nazism. Now, the progressives today realize that's bad. We don't want people to know that. So they say Nazism was regressive. It was reactionary. They were trying to sort of go back to the past. No, the Nazis invoked ancient myths, but to create the new man, and then it was very similar to the communists. The new man and the new utopia, freed from the shackles of traditional religion and traditional morality.
What, going forward with this, the death of a nation, in the trailer, there's a comparison between Donald Trump and Abraham Lincoln. That caused a lot of people to scratch their heads, even on the right. Mostly never Trumpers, but even on the right. Explain what you were trying to do there, and obviously a trailer 2 minutes long can give a half impression.
You know, I wanted the image to be provocative. Trump and Lincoln, their heads morphed. Now, why? Not because Trump is Lincoln. No. Mm. I mean, in fact, look at Lincoln. Lincoln was brooding. He was melancholy. He was philosophical. Temperamentally, he's at the opposite end of Trump. Mm. Trump is a happy warrior. He's in the mud and happy to be there and so on.
He loves it.
Yeah, he loves it. Right? Now, but the situations are pretty similar. Think of it. In 1860, an outsider, a Republican, comes into the race unexpectedly. He wins narrowly, and he wins only because it's a three-man race. Two Democrats and one Republican are in the race. Mm-hmm. And but as soon as he gets elected, all hell breaks loose. The Northern Democrats literally are openly calling for his assassination, which happens later. The Southern Democrats go, we are so unwilling to live with the result of a lawful election, we will take any means necessary to avoid that, including breaking up the country. Well, wait a minute. You know, that kind of craziness is with us now. We've got a party, and it happens to be the same party, the Democratic Party, and it will not accept the result of a lawful election, and it openly says we're going to use any means necessary. We don't care if they're ethical. We don't really even care if they're legal, because this guy, Trump, is like Hitler circa 1933, and whatever we do to get him out of there is justified.
But as far as going forward, obviously, there were extraordinary circumstances. There was a shooting, a hot civil war under Abraham Lincoln. Are you trying to imply, or are you afraid that it could come to that point? It seems like we're in a cold civil war at this moment, but I posit that the Democratic election strategy for 2018 is to keep their angry mob just below explosion. That'll keep them motivated to go and vote, but a mob is really easy to start up and get going. To direct and control is something completely different. And they seem to be playing chicken. There won't be violence before November. If there is, they're in trouble. If there isn't, that would be helpful to them. And they're playing this dangerous game of chicken. Where are you?
Well, I mean, they're playing with fire. Because, look, from the founding of the Democratic Party in the 1820s, they were doing this on slavery. The planter class got even non-slave owners. I mean, think about it. The majority of Confederates who fought in the Civil War did not own a slave.
Right.
So how'd they get into a fight? How do you get people who don't own a slave, no stake in the battle, to fight for the plantation? And the answer is you get them stirred up. You basically get them to believe that their life and their future is threatened. And so there was this cold civil war in America in the 1850s. Lincoln knew it. He smelled it. And he also recognized that the Democrats would use the threat of secession to try to get the Republicans to cancel out the result of their own election. In fact, the rhinos of their own day, the early Republicans, came to Lincoln. They said, hey, listen, you know, we campaigned to stop the growth of slavery. Let's give that up. We don't really want the country to break apart. Why don't we agree to stretch the Mason-Dixon line, the Missouri Compromise line, all the way to the Pacific, and we'll let slavery stay permanently south of that line. This was called the Crittenden Compromise. Lincoln goes, no way. He goes, I will suffer death before I agree to that. Why? Because we campaigned. We had a Democratic election. We've got an electoral majority. The people have signed off on this. It's my job now to carry it out. And for me not to carry it out is to subvert democracy itself. Not going to happen.
When you see the messaging of modern progressives, and it's sort of a theme in your last couple of books, they have become the party of anti-racism somehow, miraculously. Again, the charge of racism is always, I assume you're called a racist on a regular basis.
Well, it's downright comical because I'm exposing and dramatizing racism. I show the most vivid scenes of racial oppression.
But I bet you are subjected to racism in those allegations of racism, especially in the age of social media where you're very active.
Yeah. I mean, what's going on, if you look at the reviews of the movie, particularly by these leftist, professional leftist critics, they deliberately distort what I'm saying. Dinesh says that Hitler's a liberal Democrat. No, that's not what I say. But what I do say is that Hitler got some of his vicious, genocidal schemes from progressives and from Democrats, and that's the crushing historical truth. You can't refute that, so you're pretending like I'm saying something else. But, look, the bottom line of it is, you know, I've been accused of being a revisionist, mm-hmm. but all I'm doing is revising progressive revisionism. The progressives, starting in the 50s but continuing in the 60s, revised fascism. They revised racism. They took the racist history of the Democrats and tried to pin it on the Republicans. The party switched platforms. I'm simply blowing the lid on this fake history and fake scholarship that is the kind of ideological complement to fake news.
So when someone picks up Death of a Nation, unsuspecting, somebody maybe, they just, oh, this is kind of interesting. What do you want them, somebody who doesn't know Dinesh D'Souza, doesn't know your work, what do you want them to come away with?
You know, I've thought about this. If someone who had no exposure to my work picked this book up and they read it, they would be discombobulated because they would go, everything, or not everything, but a lot of things that I thought I knew are wrong.
And it's not just things they thought they knew they picked up over time. These are things taught to them by people whose job, it's supposed to be trusted people, teachers, journalists, news anchors, the people who are supposed to be truth tellers.
Right. So this is not just a narrative about the present. It's a narrative about our story of America. And people know things. And I sometimes ask myself, how does somebody know something, right? Now, this is how that works. A professor writes a book, Fascism and Nazism on the Right. Eight of his left-wing colleagues say, greatest book ever written on the subject, right? Then the New York Review of Books writes a laudatory review. NPR interviews the guy, and then Michael Moore rolls into town. He does a documentary. So here's my point. The ordinary guy goes, of course fascism on the right, because you know what? I was in Barnes & Noble. I thought I saw a book about that, and I turn on the History Channel, and there it was, and I look at Wikipedia, and there it is. And so literally, it's the same bullet ricocheting off 10 walls, but they think, because they've seen it so many places, it's got to be true. And this guy, Dinesh, either he's lying or he's suppressing information. And no, I'm the one who gives the other side of the story. They're the ones who suppress it.
Do you have a leftist critic who you looked at a review of one of your books or one of your documentaries and you thought, actually, they didn't like it, but I get their criticism, at least honest criticism, or is it all straight up this revisionist garbage?
No. I think that there will be some honest criticism. Now, the movie's only out, you know, the end of this, it opens tomorrow, Friday, and the book is out, but a little too early what I'm getting is the early sort of movie reviewer
types. But even past movies, the Obama's America.
There's very little, to be honest, very little honest commentary these days, I'm very sorry to say, because you can honestly engage a book. But, for example, I say that the racist Dixiecrats never moved over to the Republican camp. Out of 200 of them, one guy in the Senate, Strom Thurmond, and one guy in the House, Albert Watson, became Republicans. All the rest stayed Democrats.
And the South stayed solidly Democrat until 1994.
Correct.
If it was a Southern strategy that was supposed to what took so long?
Right. And so there's a claim. It's a factual claim. You can debate it. So here's Kevin Cruz, prominent historian at Princeton. What he does, first of all, he relies on the gullibility of his own audience. Mm-hmm. He starts saying, I'm going to start naming you a whole bunch of guys who moved over to the Republican Party. Strom Thurmond, Trent Lott, John Tower. First of all, none of those are Dixiecrats, right? And then he goes on with 20 other obscure guys that no one's ever heard of. Again, none of those are Dixiecrats. So this is sleight of hand. And this is a professor at Princeton, a seemingly legitimate historian. And then again, 12 of his colleagues start jumping up and down. Kevin Cruz owns D'Souza.
Twitter is an echo chamber. I've seen some of that.
Yeah.
It is kind of funny. But how long can you... It's a lot like beating your head against a brick wall. It's not going to come down. Are we hopelessly divided? Is it the death of a nation? Is there a way to pull back from this precipice?
There totally is. Two things. I mean, I think that if you have knowledge and you have courage, That's the combination. One is not enough. You need both.
Both are rare individually. Together is a unicorn.
That's what I'm trying to infuse in. I mean, when I speak on campus, you know, I'll speak to students and I'll say to them.
When you're allowed to speak.
Well, yeah.
And you're not shouted off stage.
Okay, so there I am on campus, right? And a typical professor, you know, at Bowdoin College, Romance Languages, just goes, Dinesh, I see you pointing the finger at the Democratic Party. You know, you have to admit there's a lot of blame on both sides. So this is when I kind of get my mind going and I go, let me offer a fact for you to consider. In 1860, the year before the Civil War, no Republican owned a slave. Now, not no Republican leader owned a slave, no Republican in the United States owned a slave. And that means that all the slaves in the country, 4 million of them, were owned by Democrats. And the beauty of the statement is that it's scientific in the sense that it's refutable, right? Mm-hmm. You give me the names of two Republicans who owned slaves, I'd have to take it back.
Right.
But to this date, no one has produced a single valid counterexample. And when students hear this, their jaw drops. Why? It contradicts everything they've been taught. No one ever told them this. Their professors have kept it from them. And I love to have their professors in the room because I can reduce them to babbling idiocy. And so this whole thing is, I mean, to me, there's an element of it that's depressing, but there's an element of it that's fun. And I think that getting into it makes you, I sometimes call it a very dangerous American.
I appreciate you coming by. A couple last things, not book related at all. The book is out now. The movie is out today because today's Friday. Check them both out. Apparently, they're two great tastes that taste great together, because if you leave the movie, you're going to want to look up the research in the book, and it's all right there. You've been in the news for other things other than your writing. You were convicted of campaign finance violations, and then you were pardoned by the president. I'm curious, how did the pardon come about? Did you actively seek the pardon, or did you wake up one day and go, holy cow, I've been pardoned?
No, I didn't seek it. In fact, I thought it was unseemly to seek it, so I didn't do that.
How did it come about?
Well, there was a social media campaign to sign petitions to the White House and so on. But the way it really came about, I believe, is Senator Ted Cruz, whom I know, and my wife knows. My wife's been very involved in Texas politics. And so we had dinner with him on a social dinner. And he goes, I'm just outraged at what happened to you, Dinesh. I'm going to go to President Trump, and I'm going to ask him to pardon you. And then Ted Cruz called me a week later. He goes, I'm in the limousine with Trump. John Kelly was in the back. And he goes, I told Trump, this is terrible. You've got to pardon Dinesh D'Souza. And he goes, the president said, done. And it was like that. Now, Ted Cruz told me it's going to take a while because there's a legal process.
How long did you know?
It was 30 days from that till I actually got the call. And Ted Cruz warned me. He said, do not put this out. Do not speak a word of it. Once you get the call, it's
then
official,
then
and the call was downright, I mean, exhilarating and hilarious. I mean,
how does, aside from restoring your right to vote, how does it change your life to be pardoned?
It's not just that I can vote and own a gun and all that stuff. It's really more that it lifts the felon label.
Yeah, you're gone. It's gone. It's like it never happened.
It's not
like clemency where you're just released, your sentence is reduced. It never happened.
I have the honor of being an ex-felon, which, as you know, is amazing because a felon leaves normally for life.
Yes.
But what it really does is it gives me my American dream back. And that's why I'm so grateful to Trump for doing that and doing it now, not waiting till the end of the term, but just giving it back to me, unleashing me in a powerful new way. And so I feel empowered.
Now, when you look at somebody like a Rosie O'Donnell, who did essentially what you did, gave multiple donations under multiple names from multiple addresses to the same people, violating campaign finance law. She claims she just did it at night and couldn't remember where she was throwing her money. And she's I'd love to have that kind of problem. I have so much money, I don't know where I'd put it.
I'm on CNN with Anderson Cooper. He goes, Rosie O'Donnell's case is totally different than yours. And I go, wait a minute. He implied it was some sort of a mistake. And I say, well, wait a minute. She had four different spellings of her name.
Right.
And five different addresses. Now, who doesn't know how to spell their own name? Obviously,
Rosie might be kind of stupid. I might buy that.
It's a repeat violation.
But she got away with it.
No one's even talking about prosecuting her. Why? Because normally those kinds of cases, absent corruption, are not prosecuted. But in my case, you know, I offended the narcissist in the White House at the time, and he unleashed Eric Holder and this Indian clown, Tweet Barrera, a sort of local henchman in New York. And these guys went after me with everything they got, and they kind of got me. But in fact, one funny thing about the CNN interview, they were like, Dinesh, you got favorable treatment. Very powerful people like Ted Cruz and Donald Trump got you off. And I go, yeah, but some very powerful people named Obama and Holder got me in the first place, so I'm kind of relieved I had some powerful people to undo what they did.
How satisfying was it for you personally seeing the outrage from the leftists, from the Bararas of the world on social media and on CNN when you were pardoned, the indignation? He was a criminal. How dare you? You might as well let Jeffrey Dahmer out of prison. Like, guy wrote a check. I don't see what the problem is.
I mean, just think
and you
it.
Did the time. It's not like you avoided punishment. You already got punishment.
I mean, I was confined, locked up for 8 months in overnight confinement with 120 hardened felons. I mean, I paid a fine. I mean, I went through a lot. I even underwent psychological therapeutic counseling mandated by the court, as if I had bodies in the refrigerator, yes, like Dahmer. Even my psychiatrist, this is a government-appointed psychiatrist in California, and she looks at my file and she goes, you don't need psychological therapy. I go, well, I've been ordered to undergo it.
Right.
And she goes, actually, the guy who needs therapy is your judge. He's alone. And then I'm getting this from, you know.
But how satisfying was it seeing
it was.
The reaction?
I mean, it was fantastic. I mean, here's Preet Bharara, you know, and he's saying, oh, it's a garden variety case, you know. And I was merely, you know, we prosecute these all the time. And I'm thinking, it's a garden variety case. At the end of the case, you've been fired, and I've been pardoned by the President of the United States. What kind of garden variety case is that?
In the end, you were the victor. Now, Dinesh, you were kind enough to sign a copy of your book, which we'll be giving away raffle size by your own. But if you want to win a signed copy, email Derek, D-E-R-E-K, at dailycaller.com. Plus, we have two of your older books, Hillary's America and America, Imagine World Without Her, that you can win signed as well. I'm keeping this one and one of those for myself. Last week, we had Sean Spicer in, and all these people entered to win a signed copy of his book. I'm going to ask you, dig in there and pick one person at random and tell the world who won.
So the winner is Jay Groves.
Jay Groves
gets the Sean Spicer book.
The Sean Spicer book. You have more chances to win next week because we have more Dinesh books to give out. Sean Spicer was cheap. I'm just kidding. Dinesh, thank you for coming. The book is out now. And the movie is out today. It's in theaters. Is it on demand or
it
anything?
Opens? No, it'll be in on demand eventually, but it's just in theaters right now, 1,000 theaters. So if you go on deathofanationmovie.com, you can watch the trailer and you can actually buy tickets. You can find out where it's playing near you.
Do both and buy the book because you're going to want to look up all the things you learned. I appreciate you coming in. Congratulations on all the success and congratulations on the pardon.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Click subscribe wherever he happens to slap it on the video. Be back here Monday for the audio version of the podcast and another version of Friday video edition next Friday. Have a great weekend.